of Missouri. It's an SEC showdown between two teams looking for their first conference win of the season. South Carolina and Missouri from Faurot Field. SEC Network Football is presented by Allstate in a series that has been a thriller. Each of the last two seasons, it's come down to the fourth quarter and dramatic comebacks for both squads. Welcome, everybody, and good morning, Como. Tom Hart alongside Heisman Trophy winner Andre Ware. The story for both of these programs, quarterbacks, freshman quarterbacks starting today for both of them. South Carolina goes with Lorenzo Nunez. He's their third quarterback to start this season because of injuries and ineffectiveness to the other two.
Yeah, but he presents a problem. Barry Odom, the defensive coordinator for Missouri, he's going to have to face a guy that is a dual-threat quarterback and make plays with his legs as well as his arm. 202 through the air, 239 on the ground, a guy that poses a lot of problems.
On the other side from Missouri, news came down the pike on Tuesday that starting quarterback Matty Mock suspended for a violation of team rules that opened the door for a very deserving freshman, Drew Locke, to make his first career start.
Yeah, he's a guy that Coach Pinkel told us has the three C's. He's cool, calm, and collected. A guy that will not be rattled, even though it's his first start. He can handle the pressure. He can handle this atmosphere. They rave about his arm talent, his accuracy, his ability to hit every area of the field.
South Carolina won the toss. They've elected to defer, so Drew Locke will be the first starting quarterback as a true freshman in Gary Pinkel's 39 years as a college coach. He will open the game for Missouri. John Gibson back to return the kick from Landon Ard, and we are ready to go on a beautiful Saturday morning in Columbia, Missouri. Gibson will take a knee, and let's go down to the field and say hello to the birthday girl, Laura Rutledge.
Well, thank you, Tom, and this Missouri O-line continues to shuffle with right tackle Nate Crawford out due to an ankle injury. Taylor Chapel will start in his place, meaning there will be five seniors starting on this O-line, and left tackle Connor McGovern told us they really wanted to refocus as a group this week. They had a Monday meeting where they challenged each other to be better, and they talked about how they need to be more consistent, have better play that way. Gary Pinkel said he's seen a better week in practice from the O-line, but he needs to see improvement in game.
All right, thank you, Laura. Running back play has been an issue. Russell Hansborough has been hurt in the first pass from Drew Locke, complete to Nate Brown, but it's a loss of two. And, Andre, this is what we expect at the outset, some easy passes for Locke to try to find the freshman.
Yeah, when you have a pure passer like Drew Locke, a pocket passer, they're going to try. The way to really get his footing in a football game is a couple of easy completions. That way you build on his confidence going forward.
He only has seven series of experience this season. Locke goes to the outside again, working the right side. And that's Clayton Ecker, the tight end. Let's take a look at the starters for the Missouri Tigers, 0-1 in conference play.
Yeah, they're gonna need some the running game from Russell Hansborough. You talked about it, Drew Locke needs a relief and pressure, so to speak. Where do you get it? You get it from the running back position in Hansborough. Connor McGovern, the left tackle, certainly gonna have to provide some protection for the youngster Drew Locke.
McGovern making his 33rd consecutive start today, but he's at a new spot this season. Locke will let it go again. Hansborough gets denied. It's another loss of yardage. T.J. Gurley comes up to make the play. 4 yards the wrong way for Mizzou. Here's South Carolina starters defensively, much maligned, but they shift some guys around, and they've been effective lately.
Yeah, their leader on the defensive side, Sky Moore, already with 3 interceptions. That leads the conference. Then Al Harris already made a play in this game. A nice stop defensively from the corner position. He is their best cover man on the outside.
The dynamic Farrell Cooper waits to return. Corey Fatone, true freshman, will kick it away. Not a good one into the wind, and Cooper will let it go across the South Carolina sideline. Gamecocks will have great field position for freshman quarterback Lorenzo Nunez. He's the first true freshman to start and win since the legendary Steve Tannehill did in 1992, and he's hoping to join Tannehill by winning his first SEC game.
Yeah, we talked to Coach Spurrier this week. He said he's a gamer, not really that You know, he won't light it up in practice, but when he gets in a game, the lights come on, it's for real. That's when you get the best from Lorenzo Nunez. And I kind of equate that with, hey, if you're getting 14 team reps, how are you going to look good in practice if you miss on one out of three? Then it's kind of hard to get the coach's attention. But boy, has he been outstanding when he's been since he's been inserted into the starting lineup.
Nunez will keep it, trying to find the edge. Try to duck in, and he gets cut down for no gain by Arian Penton. Brandon Wilds is out again for South Carolina, nursing a rib injury. So it's Sean Carson who gets a start in the backfield and a couple of other standouts.
Yeah, Farrell Cooper, maybe the best player on the field today. They'll do everything with him. Run, throw, he'll catch some. And Jarrell Adams, big tight end. Look for him to have a big day in the middle of the field. Working against zone coverage.
Two tight end formation with Adams flanked by Jacob August, a redshirt freshman from Columbia. Nunez checks the sideline. Steve Spurrier is not handling a bulk of the play calling duties. That's on G.A. Mangus, who's up in the booth, the quarterback coach. Drop snap. Mizzou will blow it up. It'll be a loss of a couple. Carson gets swamped by Charles Harris.
Bro, you're looking at two true freshmen in Zach Bailey, the center, and Lorenzo Nunez was a true freshman quarterback. Well, that is a dynamic that the coaches for South Carolina are a little bit afraid of. Two out of the three plays there, the first two plays, low snaps for Lorenzo Nunez to handle. That throws the timing of everything off.
They're the only program in the country starting a true freshman at both center and quarterback. Third and 13. Nunez pressured, and he goes down. A loss of 14. It's Walter Brady.
Or Brady, watch Brady just escape from the outside and just commit right there. He goes, works out, comes back underneath, and then he's got a clear path to the quarterback. That is where you don't want the pressure from immediately. You'd rather have it come from the outside when it's in your face, very little that you can do.
Sean Kelly to punt it away. Cam Hilton, the freshman from St. Louis, set to return. A couple of bad punts to start this game. Two offenses looking for playmakers have been put behind the chains by their punters. Missouri's known as a sack team. That time they brought an extra man, and it paid off. Both offenses going the wrong way early. What a night here. Missouri had everything going their way. They had a 17-0 lead.
Oh, no! Oh, yes! He missed it. If you're a South Carolina fan, game over.
First and goal. Hansbrough going wide. Nothing there. Cuts back. And he walks in. Touchdown, Missouri. And we have another upset as Missouri's going to beat number 13, South Carolina, 21-20.
The visor says it all. A couple of fourth quarter thrillers between these two teams. This is a trophy game. The Columbia Cup is on the line. South Carolina came back from down 17 with 12 minutes to go. Won in overtime here 2 years ago. And Missouri last year was outplayed for 53 minutes. They came back late and ended up winning it.
So what you're saying is we're set for a good one today.
And we should be, if history is any indication. Here's Hansbrough, nothing doing straight up the middle. Sky Moore in on the stop. It's a loss of one. Both offenses, Andre, looking for a playmaker. South Carolina kind of has one in Cooper, but he's really the only guy. Missouri hasn't shown one yet this year.
Yeah, they're hoping that Hansbrough can really help Drew Locke. He's fighting an ankle injury that just doesn't look himself. Tried to go last week, wasn't 100%. They felt like another week of rest. I'm going to give it a go today.
Locke to throw again, looking over the middle, and they'll dump it out to Hansbrough. Spin move ineffective against T.J. Holloman, now the starting middle linebacker who had two picks last week. And the win against Central Florida, it's a gain of four.
Yeah, you really have to credit South Carolina defensively. Al Harris with a couple of stops in the open field, out by himself, and then there T.J. Holloman. That could have gone for a big, big yardage to Hansbrough, but open field tackling, really the story here early for South Carolina.
Cam Hilton is now in at the slot, five wide receivers set for Missouri. True freshman at the top of your screen. Third and seven for the freshman, Drew Locke. Pocket holds, and he finds his man. Diving forward is Hilton for a Missouri first down, gain of 8, longest play thus far today.
Yeah, he was recruited as a safety, but now has turned into a wide receiver. They love playing him in the slot. He's uncovered, I thought, right off the ball that Drew Locke was going to go to him. He was wide open. Safety was about 12 yards deep, and Locke able to find him a little bit later.
Locke 5 for 5 to start this game. Ishwitter now his tailback. Here's Witter. Lowers his head, takes it for a gain of 4. Dante Sawyer, sophomore from Suwanee, Georgia, in on the stop.
Yeah, Witter's a solid young player. The coaches really trust him. They'd like to get him on the field a little bit more, but you see Missouri struggles with a running game. We want to get off to a good start here.
And Laura talked about the offensive line play as T.J. Gurley makes a stop on Witter, gain of 3. When we talked with Connor McGovern yesterday, his message was it has to click sometime. It better be today.
And you're talking about 5 seniors up front. But just because of the experience up front, they moved Connor McGovern from right tackle to left. That throws the chemistry off just a little bit. But there's tons of experience up front for Missouri.
Wesley Leftwich in motion, trying to look to him in the flat, and it's incomplete. Al Harris with the stop. That's a new wrinkle to the Missouri offense. They put that play in this week, trying to work against the South Carolina zone.
Yeah, just want to get a quick reaction, quick throw from Locke to one of the receivers, and all you need is a couple of yards. Put it low and in front, and he's got what he wanted, another completion, but that's his first incompletion of the ball game.
5 for 6 start. Missouri's going to keep the offense on the field, facing a 4th and 3.
I like this decision.
They're 1 of 4 on 4th downs this season. Locke will take off with it straight up the middle. He's got a 1st down and gets taken down. He does not have the reputation as a running quarterback, especially compared to Matty Mock. Most importantly, they got to keep him healthy, but this moves the chains.
Yeah, excellent blocks right in the middle of the formation. Boehm, the center, and Locke's able to pull it down. That's where he's really underrated. Everybody thinks that Matty Mock's this tremendous runner. I'll tell you what, Drew Locke, you don't have to run 4-3. He's got wheels enough to make plays.
And now Hansborough takes it for a gain of 4. Marquavius Lewis in on the stop. Locke is a great athlete. He was an all-state basketball player coming out of Lee's Summit High School in the Kansas City area.
Actually had a couple of offers to play basketball in college, but the arm talent, the coaches, talked with Josh Henson, the offensive coordinator. They rave about Drew Locke's arm talent.
9th play of the drive. 2nd possession for Missouri. Looking to Leftwich, he's got him on the sideline, but footwork wasn't quite there to turn it upfield. It's a gain of 4, and that will leave 3rd and short for the Tigers.
Yeah, Leftwich is a gifted speedster with tremendous athletic ability. It's his first year as a full-time starter. There, just a nice little quick out. I think if he's able to keep his footing, not having to really turn around, he makes a play, not only picks up the 1st down, but challenges the end zone.
3rd down 2. Hansborough straight ahead. He's got the 1st down and a bounce and a hurdle. And Hansborough takes it inside the 10. Knocked down by Isaiah Johnson, a gain of 7. And the Mizzou offense clicking now.
Yeah, it's nice blocks on the outside. They do a good job. Evan Boehm, the center, a position blocking to give Hansborough the outside edge. Looked pretty good with the ankle there.
1st and goal. Locke pulls it back, looking for the screen, fires, touchdown! Tigers, Nate Brown!
Well, they make it look like a run with a tight end, usually cracking down on the end, but he's going to escape. Eckert, the tight end, watch him here. Usually that's a kick-out block, but they fake it, they go to the pass, and he's able to find Nate Brown crossing from the backside. Nice drive, nice mix of run and pass by Josh Henson. And near perfect Drew Locke on the afternoon.
It's an 11 play, 51-yard scoring drive. Andrew Baggett on for the point after. And so the Drew Locke era gets off to a good start. His 2nd possession, he leads the Tigers on a long scoring drive. Tiger faithful, excited to see what this kid can do. They've renamed the month Locktober, and he hooks up with Brown for a 2nd touchdown pass to the young season. Lead, 7:19 to go in the first quarter. And Drew Lock showing some patience on that drive and that touchdown pass.
Yeah, he's going to, usually when you watch the film of Missouri, it's the tight end's going to block here, but they go ahead and release him. But you're going to get this from the backside. Watch Drew Lock's eyes here. Zone coverage, he gets a blitz off the edge, but it's pure zone coverage. And you look at the accuracy. Four defenders in that area, he's still able to pinpoint the ball into Nate Brown. Well, you talk about a good young talent in Drew Lock just emerging right before our eyes.
Sean Carson and Rod Talley back to receive. Corey Fatone will kick it off for the Tigers. This is Carson from the four. Past the 20, tied up there, and we'll push forward to the 25. Let's check in with Laura.
We've seen some low snaps for South Carolina early in this one, and center Zach Bailey and Lorenzo Nunez have been practicing the snaps on the sideline. They did about 10 of them, a couple of them still a little off. Bailey saying to Nunez, I think I'm rushing, I'm going too fast. Nunez saying, hey, just slow down, it's going to be okay.
Yeah, the first one I put on Nunez, the second one on Bailey, a little bit low, but it throws the timing off everything. You want to get a ball out quickly, can't do it because he's fielding the, you know, fielding, then you got to mold it and then throw.
On first down, Nunez facing a four-man rush, had a window, and he finds his man for a first down. That's Carlton Hurd. Gain of 14. Nunez is one of seven true freshmen to have started a game for a Power 5 team this season. He's the only one to start it with a true freshman center. And Bailey getting the time because of injuries to both Allen Knott, a high ankle sprain, and Cody Waldrop, a broken ankle. He's their third string center. A couple yards for Sean Carson. Ricky Hatley with the stop. Here's what the starters look like for the Tigers on the defensive side.
Yeah, Kentrell Brothers, he's the glue. He's the team's leading tackler a year ago and having an outstanding season. Second team All-SEC, fighting an ankle and a knee injury. And then Charles Harris, he's their best pass rusher. He's the guy that will really harass Nunez most of this football game.
Brothers, 33rd consecutive start, leading the nation in tackles. Blitz coming from the safety spot. Nunez trying to outrun the big guys, and he lets it go on the run, just wide and incomplete, trying to find Belton.
Yeah, and that's where he showed maybe a little bit of inexperience. The blitz came from way back in the secondary. It was late. Just sit in the pocket. Look from the all 22. You see the blitz from the linebacker for the safety. It's late. He's protected. You want to slide outside this way. The natural thing for a young quarterback to do is slide the other way or opposite, and that's where you get yourself in trouble. Stay in the pocket, stay protected. Then when you have to slide, make the slide move, and the ball comes out.
Third down, 9. Nunez can't escape. He's sacked for the second time today. Josh Moore got to him. It's a loss of 5.
Well, they wanted to eliminate big plays and create some turnovers, and that's just as good as a turnover right here from Missouri. They only rushed 4. They're able to get there. The quarterback taking a little bit too long on third and long to get the ball out. And we know that Missouri, they are known, there's a history here of getting pressure with just the front 4.
They've set a school record for sacks each of the last 2 seasons. It was Marcel Frazier that time. End over end kick. Hilton lets it hop in front of him. Had to wait for it to come down. It may have paid off. A crushing block, and Hilton turns the corner. Cam Hilton will take it down the sideline, but we got multiple flags all the way back at the 20.
Yeah, this one's going to come back. Maybe a block in the back right around the 20-yard line, and it was close. Not sure the head was in front. We'll get a chance to see it here on the replay, but that's exactly what's happened. This long punt return is going to come back.
54-yard punt, 62-yard return, all for nothing. For the Webster
Boyd High
School product.
Illegal block in the back, number 4, receiving team. 10-yard penalty, spot of the foul, first down, timeout.
So that wipes off the biggest gain of the day for either side. It'll be the third possession for Missouri and Drew Lock. That close to a long run But the flag flies and the Tigers backed up when we return. Work alternate channel at 7:30. SEC football all day on the SEC Network. Who do you like in that Mississippi State A&M?
I'm going with the Bulldogs in the upset now. Even though it's at Kyle Field, I feel like they can run the football. Dak Prescott, arguably the best quarterback in this conference.
Missouri's running game finds nothing there. Ish Witter with the carry on the left side. Those might be the two best quarterbacks in the league going head-to-head. One is already there and established himself in Dak Prescott. The other one, Kyle Allen, coming along nicely.
Yeah, certainly growing. Kyle Allen, have to be impressed with him. And almost lost that job against Arizona State in the opener. Kyler Murray got hurt. Kyle Allen came back in, played well, and he's been doing that ever since.
True freshman quarterback Drew Lock at the controls for Missouri. He gets pressured, trying to get rid of it in the end zone. He had a receiver in the area. Cedric Cooper brought the pressure. They're going to rule him down at the one.
Boy, he got lucky there.
It's a loss of 9.
I mean, just the pressure from the outside. He wanted to throw a quick out. And well, this is close to where the ball comes out.
Yeah, he was official in the pocket.
Yeah, blew the whistle and right about the half-inch yard line.
He was in the pocket. He did not get back to the line of scrimmage. He was
want to hurry and run a play here.
Got a break to Jason Reese, the tight end, was in the vicinity. If it's intentional grounding in the end zone, it's a safety. So, 3rd and 19 now.
Yeah, we're going to take a look. Snap that baby quickly if I was Gary Pinkel. Maybe I think they're going to take a timeout here.
I think he was wondering about the play clock. Missouri takes the timeout. Tom Ritter, our referee today, having a discussion on the sideline with the fourth winningest active coach in college football, Gary Pinkel. His counterpart on the other side, Steve Spurrier, second only to Frank Beamer among active coaches in wins.
The longest coaches just didn't leave this program. It took 7 years, a lot of continuity in the staff of Gary Pinkel. 7 years, the same staff, that allowed him to build a tremendous foundation here at Missouri.
Time out, time out. Missouri, that is their first charge timeout of this half.
Tom, when you can have coaches stay together that long, good things happen. You can build a program.
And they have. The both teams desperate for a win today. We step away for a timeout with 4:04 to go in the first. Top leading by touchdown here. That last play adding some confusion to the day's festivities. The officials ruled his forward progress was stopped. Drew Lock was outside of the end zone. And the whistle blew there, so not reviewable. At that point, even though, boy, oh, boy,
that is close. And we've seen it go a lot longer than that before forward progress was ruled that he'd actually stopped.
So Drew Lock has his work cut out for him here, 3rd and 19.
Now it's just get rid of the football, get anything positive without making a mistake here.
Pressure coming again. Pocket holds, and he finds Jamon Moore. Moore gets twisted down inside the 10 in a punting situation for the Tigers.
That's where you don't want to make a mistake this deep in your own end of the field. And got a receiver, Jamon Moore, down. They've got more than their share of injuries this year at that position. Really need him to step up. Ankle gets rolled up. You'll see it right here at the end, kind of caught at the bottom right there.
And Andre, they can't afford to lose wide receivers.
No.
It's not the same caliber of a wide receiver core as we've seen from Missouri in years past.
I mean, that was just caught right under the defender there. Hopefully he'll be okay. They need every weapon around a young quarterback that they can get today. But I've been impressed with Drew Lock and his patience of John Hoke, the defensive coordinator for South Carolina. He loves to run a lot of two deep zone, and it forces you to be patient as a quarterback, and Lock has shown that.
First punt from Fatone with 24 yards. That one a little bit better into the wind. A 40-yarder from the freshman from Franklin, Tennessee. Nunez, one of two
through the air. He's been sacked twice and he's lost 19 yards. This is the second Carolina possession to start in Mizzou territory, but nothing to show for it just yet. A little bit different in the play calling now for South Carolina. On play action, Nunez going deep. He's got Cooper, and he hauled it in.
What a catch.
Over the top of Arian Pettin and Farrell Cooper, the playmaker, a gain of 35 and a Carolina first down.
Boy, this is just throw up the jump ball and allow the best player on the field to make a play. Excellent coverage. He just finds a way to basically willed his way to that catch over Penton.
And you assume that's a play call that came from the head ball coach. He said, I still have impact in the passing game and now the running game. But this one never got off. We got a whistle.
Maybe want to take a look at that last reception by Cooper.
The snap, we were notified from the replay booth that the prior play is under further review.
That's a tough break for South Carolina. Looked like they had six on the board.
Sean Carson is going to walk into the end zone, but watch the footwork here on the outside by Cooper. It's clearly there. 1 foot's in. That's all you need in college football. Maintains it through the end of the catch. I think it's a catch. Nothing there to really overturn it. I think this is a catch. See the end of it. You just right there, he's got the football, he goes down, and all the other stuff happens at the end. I think this is going to stay a catch by Cooper, and what a catch it was. Be on everybody's highlight tonight.
Gain of 35. Head ball coach said, I don't have much experience calling a lot of running plays, so guys in the booth, G.A. Mangus upstairs and Sean Elliott, the co-offensive coordinator, handling the run calls.
After review, the ruling on the field is confirmed. It was a good catch. First down.
So first down for South Carolina, but it looked like they had six before that one was called off. David Williams was the running back who had an open lane straight up the middle. Williams will come out now, and they'll replace him in the backfield with Sean Carson.
I thought it was Carson before. You're right, it was Williams. Williams, the four-star.
How about this? We got Cooper Philadelphia.
They're known to do this quite a bit, and he can throw from this situation. High school quarterback.
Threw for a touchdown last year. Sam Deal looking in zone. Carson just off his fingertips. Oh, it was right there. Andre saw it with his crystal ball, but South Carolina couldn't convert.
That played quarterback his senior year in high school. Wanted to be a free safety, and right off the fingertips. Wanted to place free safety coming in at South Carolina. All those defensive backs that they were putting into the NFL, and that's what he saw himself doing. Coach Spurrier said, no, you're too much of a playmaker. We need you on the offensive side of the ball.
He lasted for a week on the defensive side.
Now watch the corner route right here to Adams, the tight end. I mean, it is set up trips left, and you got this with a couple of underneath routes. A lot of room in the left corner.
Nunez looks over the middle. Now he's got a run with it, and he throws it out of bounds. Charles Harris, perhaps the next great pass rusher in Missouri.
I come back to the exact same formation. You get man-to-man from Barry Odom, the defensive coordinator of Missouri. Go back to trips and let the big tight end at 6'6", 231 work the corner of the end zone. I mean, it is absolutely there. They go right back to the same set. That smash route out of trips. A little bit different look now. Defensively, they're going zone defense, zone here.
Nunez pressured again. Tries to get away from it, but can't. Sack number three. There's Missouri defense. Walter Brady with his second of the game.
One thing you're trying to accomplish as a defensive coordinator is to make a young quarterback feel pressure when it's really not there. He is protected, but he's feeling the pressure step up. And all of a sudden, Missouri, they do a nice job of rallying once the timing of the play is thrown off.
Elliott Frye on to attempt a 34-yard field goal. He hit two long ones last week, two over 50. Wind swirling today. The snap was high. He punches it through. So South Carolina put some points on the board. Missouri with a big sack to push it back after they had it in the red zone. 7-3, first quarter from Como. The first time, 7-3, Missouri on top. And for an injury update on Jamon Moore, let's throw it down to Laura.
Well, Moore injured his left ankle on that last series, and they've taped it up down here. He's tested it out a little bit, says he's good to go, but something to watch for. And certainly they need him as much as they can get from him in this receiving corps.
Laura, thank you. It was an ugly injury as Missouri tried to get it out from their own end zone. Got tied up and rolled over by Sky Moore. John Gibson, the return man for Missouri. Landon Ard, senior from Rock Hill, South Carolina, to kick it off. Each of the last 2 years, this game has come down to the wire. Offenses that had been dormant for three quarters in each scenario came alive in the fourth. And Steve Spurrier last year in Columbia lamented not going for two early in the game. It's the same frustrations. 1965 Sugar Bowl loss to Missouri, and they'll honor that team that beat Spurrier's Gators. Touchdowns in the last 7 minutes of the game for the Tigers in the other Columbia. Gibson 6 yards deep will take a knee.
Tough team. We had an opportunity to see both the past couple of weeks, and I just feel like Alabama's primed for that type of game.
Freshman Drew Locke takes the snap and hands it off. A big hole straight up the middle for Ish Ritter. It's a gain of 16.
Boy, basically the same formation they ran on the goal line. Watch the tight end come across. He blocks, and then the handoff underneath. Before, it was the tight end coming across, faking the block, releasing up the field, and then locked throwing the touchdown pass to Nate Brown. We're making a lot of things look similar, but different variations off the same play.
Locke put it on the turf and able to fall on it. The issue at the handoff, it'll be a loss of two.
Well, Ish Winter, Witter, they get, he really gives them kind of a home run hitter back there. Here, just high handoff around the, basically the shoulder of Ish Witter. Hard to handle that one.
So second down, 12. Back to the Ryan game. Winner ran into his own man, able to burst free to the 49, a gain of 9.
Boy, they're formationing to the running game. Got everybody split out. It's a balanced formation, but the slot receivers as well as the wideouts are all the way out to the numbers. It's just five offensive linemen, the quarterback, and Ish Witter. And you get big splits, nice blocking angles for the five guys up front.
It's a running game that's been non-existent this season for Missouri, 116th in the nation in rushing yardage. Floating snap, and it's complete to the outside. He finds Nate Brown, getting a 5 and a first down. Rico McWilliams with coverage.
We talked to Josh Henson, the offensive coordinator from Missouri. He said somebody has to step up and become a playmaker. Well, it seems like it's a sophomore, Nate Brown, with one touchdown catch and a big third down conversion there to keep this drive moving. Boy, I'll tell you what, four in the middle there. That's calling for a draw play.
Locke looks over the middle, and it's incomplete, just a tad behind his intended man. Yeah, Jason Reese, the tight end.
Anytime you see a 4-1 front, where it's just four down defensive linemen and one linebacker, watch him in the middle, just kind of asking for a draw play. You know the linebackers are going to drop deep. There you're actually bringing them back to the party. One linebacker will drop an underneath handoff, and you have more blockers than they do defenders.
Well, Missouri runs 55% of its plays from four wide receiver sets, second only to A&M.
Now, there it is.
And room for Ritter to the outside. And forced out of bounds after a gain of 15.
Yeah, even if it's a 4-2 front, then you still have as many to block. And you see here the two linebackers in the middle, four defensive linemen. That's a run formation or a run defense for Missouri. You get six on six. And then now it's up to Ish Witter to find a nice little crease and pick up the first down, which is exactly what he did.
Play clock at one. Pardon me, quarter clock. And that's going to end their first quarter this morning in Columbia. Well, the Drew Lock era off to a start. Touchdown on his second drive, and as Faroe Field fills up for this SEC showdown, we've got a tight one, just as we anticipated. One quarter in the books. Tigers up by four. Ball game. Tigers lead the Gamecocks 7-3 as we start the second quarter. The storyline, two freshman quarterbacks going head-to-head, true freshman. Thus far, Nunez has been chased out of the pocket. He's gone backwards for 22 yards with the sacks. He's thrown for 50. Drew Lock completed each of his first five passes. He's off to a 9-for-11 start.
Yeah, we talked about him being calm, cool, and collected. Well, he's shown us that very thing. Under pressure, standing in there, delivering the football, taking shots, and then the touchdown pass to Nate Brown. He executed to perfection.
Drew Lock already has an SEC look with the Bama bangs. He showed up on campus ready. They wanted to redshirt this kid, but he played so well in fall camp. He was really the best quarterback on the field. Gary Pinkel loyal to his starter, Matty Mock. Worked Lock in for a second quarter series all year, and that's paid off in the running game. Paying off. Hansborough straight ahead, takes it inside the 10. A 23-yard pickup, chased down finally by Montquavius Lewis.
Yeah, Hansborough is a speedy back who has power to really grind out extra yards after he engages with defenders. Always seems to fall forward once he has the momentum, and boy, can he hit a hole fast as he did there.
Making the offensive line look good today. Here he is trying to get to the edge. The vision stumbled, found the pylon, but just outside of it. And Hansborough stepped out of bounds at the 3.
Did you find that an interesting comment yesterday when we talked to Coach Pinkel? He said good running backs make an offensive line look good and not the reverse.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you have a guy like Hansborough going the way he has the last couple of runs, boy, it certainly fixes things up front along the offensive line.
Second and goal. Lock kept it, and he'll get swallowed. I think Gary Pinkel's point when he said that was the offensive line can be, you know, a bunch of all pros, but you have to have a playmaker. You have to have talent in the backfield, or it doesn't matter.
A guy that knows how to hit the hole, when to hit it, when to be patient, and allow the line to set themselves, or set blocks up, and things of that sort. Just found that an interesting dynamic or way of explaining it for a guy that's been in the business as a full-time coach for 39 years.
Another long drive. This is the 10th play of the drive. They're going with a jumbo look here, and a timeout, I believe, will be taken by the Missouri side.
Timeout, South Carolina.
Nope, South Carolina uses
their first charge. Timeout in this half.
And that'll get the Tigers looking at a third and goal under Gary Pinkel. And Pinkel mentioned the fact that, listen, I've been in coaching for 39 years. I've never started a true freshman at quarterback. He's been lucky over the years. They've always had a succession plan in place that was thrown to the wind this week when Matty Mock was suspended on Tuesday. The beauty of it is that they had been giving Drew Lock some reps.
Yeah, James Franklin, Matty Mock was ready to step in, and there were guys before him, Chase Daniel, you know, followed someone. So he's always had the luxury of playing a quarterback that had some experience. Drew Lock, this is uncharted waters for Gary Pinkel.
It must come with a little bit of stress when you've got such an important game and a guy that is going to get better the more reps he gets.
Yeah, you're just hoping that he doesn't force the issue, takes care of the football, because that's where a young quarterback and a coaching staff can become frustrated, is if he starts to turn the football over, make some mistakes, gets, you know, maybe forcing the issue. So far, so good. He's shown tremendous patience.
Lock, lobs, end zone, jump ball knocked away. Chris Moody with the coverage for South Carolina. They're trying to find that big tight end that they love in the red zone, Jason Reese.
Yeah, and he's become more of a receiving threat. They put the big body on the outside and just basically throw him a jump ball. They throw it a little bit higher than that. You guys, 6'5", he can climb the ladder for you.
Andrew Baggett on to attempt the field goal. This will be a 21-yarder. Baggett missed a chip shot against South Carolina 2 years ago that ended the game in overtime. And he punches it through, so Missouri with a touchdown lead early in the second quarter from Faurot Field. Brought to you by Allstate, and the best playmaker for South Carolina, Farrell Cooper.
Yeah, on the outside, climbs the ladder, makes an outstanding catch. I don't know that you're going to find one around college football better than that one this today.
Well, he is versatile. He can do a little bit of everything. He's on the Maxwell Award, the Horning Award, and the Blitnikoff Award watch list.
What's amazing is you know they're going to get him the football at some point.
Right.
And you have the coverage right there, and you're guarding against it, yet the guy still finds ways to make plays.
And to think he wanted to be a defensive back.
Oh, his future is well on its way on the offensive side in the NFL.
They're looking for some support for Cooper, and they haven't found it just yet. Fatone to kick it away. Sean Carson back up and let that one go over his head. Let's check in with Laura.
Well, Missouri athletic training staff has been working on defensive tackle Terry Beckner Jr.'s right hand. They've been taping it around his glove, focusing on his thumb. And I'm told this is an injury that happened earlier in the season. His hand's been a little banged up, and it's lingering, bothering him a little bit today.
A talented freshman. They're asking a lot of Beckner, one of the top recruits in the country, especially, Andre, after the offseason when they lost Harold Brantley.
Yeah.
Pro prospect who was injured in a car accident.
Yeah, they really needed Beckner to step up, and he does some things as a young player that the coaches really just rave about. Solid inside pass rusher, plays a run well. A good one.
A lot of shifting up front, and we got a flag. South Carolina may have reacted to it.
False start. 71 offense. 5-yard penalty remains. First down.
That's fifth-year senior Brandon Schell, who's moved to the left side. He had 35 consecutive starts at right tackle before he made the move.
Yeah, he made the same move that Connor McGovern made for Missouri, moving from the right to the left. And he was a South Carolina Player of the Year coming out of high school.
A little misdirection. Nunez trying to keep it, and he will scramble out of bounds at the 20. We get a flag late after a shove when Nunez crossed over onto the apron.
Yeah, that'll be a free 15 and an automatic first down for South Carolina. He's so dynamic as a runner, and you really can't get lost in that if you're South Carolina. I think he's growing as a passer, and you need to continue to feed that growth.
Well, Steve Spurrier mentioned he's got great arm strength, but he also began fall fourth on the depth chart.
It's a little bit easier for him to run or get the quarterback runs if he's completing passes. The defense is off. The running lanes are going to be there for him, but you've got to show that you're committed to throwing the football rather than just having him run around back there and try to make plays with his legs.
This is an awfully long discussion on what seemed to be automatic to the naked eye. There were two flags that were thrown. And that late hit out of bounds on Nunez, as you mentioned, would be an automatic first down. Well, head ball coach watching. Nunez, the first true freshman to start for Steve Spurrier since some guy by the name of Jesse Palmer got the start against Auburn in 1997.
There were two fouls on the play, one by each team. We had a personal foul, late hit out of bounds, number 3, defense. We had a dead ball, personal foul, number 15, offense. Those penalties offset. Second down.
Well, I think Coach Spurrier is in agreement with what just happened. You see the late hit out of bounds coming from Browning.
Oh, and then 15 followed it up at the top of your screen.
Just erased everything. Let's do it again.
It cost South Carolina first down. The net after the end of that is a 1-yard gain. I bet Steve Spurrier is not too happy that his quarterback took a hit on the sideline. Then his wide receiver delivered the same. Second down, 14, design draw.
Nunez escapes one man. Now he's trying to outrun the defense. We'll pick up five on a long run by the freshman from Kennesaw, Georgia.
Able to do so and shows you some pretty good athletic ability outrunning Kentrell Brothers, who had an angle on him, but just broke a tackle there. He's able to outrun Brothers to get to pick up the 5 or 7 yards or so and get this in a manageable third down situation. But you know, one thing I realize as a running quarterback is it gets you tired. Yeah. Still in third down and long, and now you're asked to throw the football down the field. Still winded from the play before. It's not going to be much accuracy to it.
On third and eight, flush to his left side, finds his man, and that will be a South Carolina first down.
Nice.
Patrick Belton, who committed that personal foul that negated a first down a couple plays ago, makes good with a 10-yard gain.
Yeah, he's stepping in for Debo Samuel, who is out and really hadn't practiced this week, nursing a hamstring injury. They needed someone to step up, and it's been Meldrick Baylor, excuse me, Belton, that stepped up for South Carolina here.
A lot of runs in the South Carolina offense, not all of them by design with the Missouri pressure. Here's David Williams. No game.
I'm seeing Williams, who was highly recruited out of Philadelphia. Mentioned that earlier, and then Sean Carson as well has been in, but we're all playing behind Brandon Wiles, the big 6'2", 220-pound back that runs with speed and power. He's out because of some cracked ribs. May be able to get him back next week, but what a talent he is. He jumped on the scene when, as a true freshman, when Marcus Lattimore went down with a knee. He stepped in and had an excellent season.
Nunez tried the quick pop and overthrew Jarrell Adams. That one came out a little wobbly.
That's hard to do at 6'6", 231. Yeah. Overthrow the big tight end who we thought would have a big day today working against this two deep zone coverage. It's tailor-made for him. And you turn the film on with Jarrell Adams, he's just making plays and had a nice game last week for Nunez.
Adams had 3 catches, 47 yards against UCF in the home win for South Carolina.
And just two man across the board. You see it, two safeties, and they are locked up man to man.
Another third and long. Nunez looking for a block. Williams tried to give him one, and he's tripped up.
He's close. He is
Kenyon
close.
Dennis, let's see where the spot is.
They back out. They make it look like two man. It's tight coverage at the pre-snap read for Nunez, but they back away. And that's why there was deep, they were deep or running lanes for him. You see everybody backing off, and then now there's room for Nunez to run. He extends. Boy, it is close.
They're going to keep the offense on the field. You see where the spot was? It was just a half yard short on the field. They marked it a yard short.
This is where I don't like shotgun offenses right here. It allows for penetration. You can't run the old quarterback sneak and just get in there for a half yard.
They're 4-6 on fourth down this year. Williams straight ahead, first down and more. Nice change of direction, and he lowers his shoulder into Tiger territory. Gain of 16. Dennis finally brought him down.
Did a rush for over 1,900 yards as a senior. Did a nice job of freezing the defensive end, Charles Harris, where he can't pinch down and make that play. He's trying to account for Nunez.
Nunez hits Cooper, and Cooper forced out of bounds by Dennis.
Is he going to be a weapon on the next level? He does it all. He can be an excellent slot receiver for someone, as well as flip out and play outside once he learns all the positions.
South Carolina going with a little tempo, and they're going to the air. Cooper with the screen. A nice blocking on the edge from Belton. Gain of 7. You get the feeling now, with this tempo in the passing game, that the head ball coach is the one on the headset setting in the plays instead of the running game and G.A. Mangus from upstairs. This will be the 10th play of the drive. They've opened it up now behind the freshman quarterback, Nunez. He's going to go to Cooper again. Same play. And they're just chipping away. They're getting the ball into the hands of their best playmaker. It's a gain of 7.
And that's what you do. You feed your horse. And Cooper makes this offense go. Just find ways to get him the football.
And now Williams swallowed up by Josh Augusta. Loss of 2.
Oh, he can really move for a player with his size, 6'4", around 335. Played in all 14 games as a true freshman, has a ton of experience now in his junior year, and he is an excellent run stuffer.
Third and five for South Carolina. They are just 1 of 5 on third downs today.
It seems like
play the drive.
Seems like they've lived in third downs for most of this game. Yeah.
Cooper in motion. Nunez looking, looking, and looking. Finally dials to the end zone, underthrown. We got a flag on the play back of the line of scrimmage. Penton and Ian Simon both converged on the football and each other.
It'll be a late hit here. Back for the quarterback, Nunez threw the football. So he had a receiver at the top open for a long time. He just hung the ball in the air.
Targeting number 79. Defense. That'll be a 15-yard penalty. That play will be under further review.
If the call stands, Terry Beckner Jr., the freshman from the east side of St. Louis, will be ejected from the game for targeting.
Just talked earlier about, you see right there at the top of the screen, was wide open for a long time, and then Nunez saw it late.
Well, now they'll go to the video replay to see if the targeting call will stand on Terry Beckner Jr.
We talked earlier about how important he was to this defense.
Robert Rougeau is a replay official for this SEC crew today. I mean, he definitely hit him, but my question, Andre, is, you know, where was the contact? Where was it initiated?
He's hoping that it's just the penalty and the targeting, and without the targeting. At 79 here after Nunez throws the football. Seeing the receiver late, and then right there, it's helmet to helmet. I don't know if that's enough for an ejection, right?
Player safety issue at hand. That's the genesis of the targeting rule a couple of years ago.
I get it, but it wasn't much of a launch. He didn't launch. He just kind of made contact with the helmet and then a shove at the end of it.
Yeah, it's contact to the head or neck area or targeting with a hit by the crown of helmet in any situation. Well, those are the two ways to look at it. And obviously the quarterback is one of the main positions that they're trying to protect in this scenario.
After review, the ruling on the field stands. Number 79 is disqualified. We will go half the distance to the goal. First down.
Yeah, the replay didn't necessarily confirm the call. It merely stands. But Beckner ejected. He'll sit out the rest of this game, and Garrett Pinkel's squad down a man on the defensive line. He's been rotating in with Augusta and Hatley, really a three-man rotation, so we might see more of Josh Moore or A.J. Logan up front. A couple of costly penalties against Missouri on this drive for South Carolina, and the freshman quarterback with a new tilde added to his jersey, Lorenzo Nunez.
We got Cooper right there in the slot. That's where Nunez may take a look.
Play action, Nunez gonna keep it on the read. Gets spun around for no gain. Cantrell Brothers there, the stop for Missouri, leading the nation in tackles.
I'm surprised about, you know, in terms of how much Nunez is running the football, just the number of quarterback runs that are called, especially when you're thin at the position, which is how he got his opportunity to begin with.
Well, it's the number of plays called and then the number of times he's been forced to run and when it hasn't been called. Missouri will use a timeout here as South Carolina looks at a second and goal. You know, Lorenzo Nunez with the pressure or perceived pressure, right, as you pointed out, has been in a situation where he's chosen to run on some called pass plays.
Yeah, and then there, the designed run, I mean, a couple of them have been quarterback runs that are called or quarterback draws that have been called for him to run it. It's kind of surprised, as thin as they are at quarterback, that's been dialed up as much as it has here in the first half.
Missouri had 12 men on the field. They'll buy the way out of it by taking the timeout before the snap.
That is their second charge timeout.
And so some miscommunication for Barry Odom's.
This will be a 30-second timeout.
.9 to go before the half. Celebrating its 10th year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets, Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kick. Since 2005, Allstate has donated millions in scholarship funds. Tom Hart, Andre Ware, Laura Rutledge on this beautiful Saturday afternoon in Columbia. There's a trophy on the line in this one. They're playing for the Columbia Cup. It takes a while to build a tradition, right?
Yeah, a lot of similarities. Columbia, both teams from Columbia, their respective states, starting true freshman quarterbacks. A lot going on between these two teams. A lot of similarities between these two teams.
Nunez will roll right, looking for Cooper. He's covered. Pressured, Nunez, back foot. Carson takes it in. Sean Carson off the deflection from Arian Penton, and South Carolina has the touchdown.
Just pure luck. And as soon as Nunez gets to the sideline, if I'm Steve Spurrier, I'm coaching him up. This is a bad decision that worked out in their favor. With Carson being right there and Penton in coverage. But you just don't throw this football. You're rolling right. You're throwing back inside. It should have been intercepted. It's picked up by Carson and run in. But boy, am I right in his ear immediately.
13 plays, 75-yard scoring drive for South Carolina. They eat up 4 minutes and 22 seconds, and they have tied the game on a lucky bounce off the carom. Missouri had two chances at interceptions on that drive, dropped them both. And Missouri fans watching this play saying that infamous north end zone is at it again. South Carolina catches a break. Carson finishes it off with great hand-eye coordination, and we are tied at 10. It's expected a tight one in Columbia, tied at 10 between the Gamecocks and Tigers. Sean Carson with the catch on the carom.
Yeah, this really should have been a throwaway or just a run. But to stop, evade it, and then throw late back to that area of the field. Just a nice heads-up play by Carson.
Carson finally finds a hit. He started in center field here in Columbia for Chad Holbrook's Gamecock baseball team in 2013. He's having a better weekend already. That weekend, he went 0-for-7 at the plate.
I decided to concentrate on football. And tell you what, he reminds me of a smaller T.J. Yeldon with his running style.
Low line drive into the wind. That one will trickle out of bounds, and Missouri will catch a break. Well, it's a week of transition for Missouri after starting quarterback Matty Mauch, one of the best quarterbacks in Missouri history. And there's been a great litany under Gary Pinkel, top 10 in touchdowns, passing yards, and total offense. But suspended for the week on Tuesday. Gary Pinkel reiterated with us yesterday that they will revisit Matty Mauch's suspension tomorrow and figure out where they stand. It's been a trying week for the Mauch family. His father, a high school coach down in Springfield, Missouri, underwent surgery for colorectal cancer on Monday. His brother Ben, the former quarterback at Wake Forest in Cincinnati, took over and coached the team last night at the high school level. And now Matty dealing with the suspension and what that means specifically is he's basically away from the program the entire week. Not at the stadium today. Nothing doing on the ground game. It's a loss of 4. And for more on what his week looks like, let's go down to Laura.
Well, Gary Pinkel handles every suspended Missouri player the same way. They have access to the training table, which is the medical staff, and also academic support throughout the week of their suspension. But as you said, Tom, no access to anything else. They meet on Sunday. They lift weights. And he will meet on Sunday and Monday with Gary Pinkel to reassess the situation.
Yeah, he wasn't the other one suspended. Malik Cuellar, backup tackle, was also suspended. Leap by Jason Reese, the tight end, and I think that's the suspension in and of itself is one thing to not play in the game, Andre, but when you're only allowed to go into the training room to get treatment,
total isolation.
Yeah.
I mean, you are isolated away from the program. You can't really have anything to do with it. And you know, he gave a couple of examples of suspended players that had actually come out for warm-up or they're on the sideline. He says, no, that's not the way it works here at Missouri.
On third down, Drew Locke, the true freshman, has room to run if he can turn the corner, and he will reach for the first down. The other part of that conversation that we had with Gary Pinkel was very interesting. The question that we posed to him is, if Matty Mauk is to return and Drew Locke tears it up today, then what do you do at the quarterback position? And his answer was succinct. It was direct. He said, what Drew Locke does on the field today will have absolutely no impact on what we do with Matty Mauk going forward. And that could be interpreted a couple of different ways as Locke fires to the outside and finds his man Jamon Moore, and Moore almost broke through. There's a flag on the play.
There's a flag there, but I was kind of surprised at the comment or his answer, because the way they've actually been struggling on the field, and there have been boo birds here at home with the struggles offensively. So if you find a player like Drew Locke, who they rave about his arm talent, if he lights it up today and you take care of some of the struggles that you've had offensively, how could you not stay there with arguably the future of this program?
Illegal block in the back, number 35, offense, 10-yard penalty, replay first down.
And Tyler Hunt in at running back with that penalty, but and you'll see it as he comes in right there. Has nothing to do with the play, and it's going nowhere else but out of bounds. Just going to be a little bit smarter than that. But I was kind of surprised by his answer that, you know, he wouldn't commit one way or the other.
And if you want to look deeper into it, there could be an angle with Matty Mauk. He said it'll have no effect on our decision on Matty. There's no guarantee that Matty Mauk is returning to active play tomorrow or Monday.
Exactly.
And Drew Locke gets dropped. Dante Sawyer comes in with a sack. It's a loss of seven. It's a first and penalty, then offensive line failure.
They're able to get there in a hurry. He gets past Mitch Hall, the right guard. A little stunt going around the right to the defense's right, and able to get himself free and clear on his way to Drew Locke. But that's what John Hope wants, the front four in this two-deep zone look to get the pressure. That's where they need the pressure to come from, are those four guys right there.
On second down, Locke finds Hansborough. Hansborough finding his way through traffic, picks up eight.
Kind of gets it to third down where it's manageable now. You know, we talked to John Hope earlier in the week. He said, we're going to force him. We want to make him uncomfortable with the front four rushing, but force him to work his way down the field. Let's see if he can show the patience as a young player. You talk to people around the Missouri program, they says he's got, you know, the poise of a 10-year vet.
6 months ago, he was at his high school prom. Locke stands tall, fires sidearm, and he finds his tight end. He changed his delivery to fit it through to Jason Reese, brought down by Jordan Diggs. It's a gain of 17.
I'll tell you what, he keeps playing like that, he's going to make the decision extremely hard for Gary Pinkel and his coaching staff to go back the other way and shift gears, go back to Matty Mauk. I mean, that is as classic a delivery, nice, quick, and snapped it off for a big-time completion.
Play action. Mauk finds his man. That's the tight end again, Jason Reese, sophomore from Euless, Texas.
You talked about changing positions in which he releases. There's another example. Off the plate fake, you can't get it up to the classic position to throw it. It's just got to be the play fake and a flick. And a lot of quarterbacks can't do that. He certainly has shown you he can change the angles of how he delivers the football, and quickly and with accuracy.
His dad Andy played here under Woody Woodenhofer and Bob Stoll back in the doldrums of Missouri football. Ritter with the spin move back in the mid-80s. Pick up a 10 now.
I mentioned earlier, five seniors on the offensive line getting tremendous push. A nice block by left guard Brad McNulty opens that thing up for Witter. And when you have some success in the passing game, you can move it around. Now you don't have guys that are just coming up the field. They're able to find some blocking angles and get this running game started.
Balanced attack, 10th play of the drive. Locke looking. And he fires complete again to the sideline. Pickup of 8. That time Wesley Leftwich, the local product out of Columbia Hickman.
Got to give credit where credit's due. It's pretty. It's exciting to watch that classic release of Drew Locke and how he's able to push the ball down the field with poise. John Hoke, can he drive his team 80 yards? Can he stay patient the entire time? Well, he is showing that all through the first half of this game.
It was just short of the marker, 2nd and 1. Locke looked left, comes back right, patient, fires! Touchdown! Nate Brown, his 2nd of the day.
It might just be a new sheriff in town. Watch this. I mean, this is as pretty as it gets. He just strokes that thing right in there to Nate Brown, who Josh Henson told us he needed to find playmakers. There needed to be somebody to step up and make plays for this true freshman quarterback, and it's been Nate Brown with 2 touchdown receptions here in the first half. What a throw.
A pair of 11 play scoring drives for Missouri. And the 2 touchdown drives, they've been long, sustained drives led by Drew Locke. The key has been the balance, and Drew Locke throws for his 2nd touchdown of the day. A couple of hookups with Nate Brown, and it's the Tigers back in front. Drew Locke living up to the hype. That last drive from Missouri, another extended one. Yeah, 11 nice. Plays, 65 yards.
Nice job working the pocket, working the outside edges of the defense. Then here, a nice run, keeping South Carolina off balance with a run. And then the touchdown pass. Look at this. The speed, the accuracy on that ball. Had a little smoke on it. Answering a touchdown drive by South Carolina, the young quarterback, Drew Locke, came right back. 7 of 7, 70 yards, and the touchdown pass to Nate Brown. Perfect on that drive.
Is that pretty good?
That's pretty good. That's pretty good. I should be asking you that as the Missouri guy here.
Well, sometimes expectations get out of whack for a backup quarterback, right? I mean, they're always the most popular guy in town, especially after a loss. But the fact is that Drew Locke earned this start in the sense that he was the best performing quarterback throughout the entirety of camp. Gary Pinkel may have wanted to redshirt him.
Couldn't.
But Locke forced his hand. And an offense that has scuffled all season suddenly is.
And he might just continue to force his hand in terms of his play. 2 touchdown passes here in the first half, and they have been, let's just be frank about it, they've struggled offensively. And this is the best they've looked as an offensive unit, and it's coming at the hands of Drew Locke.
They only had 47 points in 3 games against FBS opponents. And now Nunez, a true freshman, caused the equipment room to go into overtime this week. They realized that he didn't have a tilde over his name, and the South Carolina equipment room doesn't exactly have a file cabinet full of tildes.
Well, there it is.
Yeah. Ryan Fisher, the assistant director of equipment operations, brought the fabric out, some scissors, did arts and crafts times, fixed the jersey, and now he fits it to Farrell Cooper for a first down.
Well, nice job there. You saw the athletic ability of Nunez as he works the pocket, moving around. He's going to have a little bit more of that in terms of moving around, making plays in the passing game to open up some things in the run game.
Cooper, 5 catches, 73 yards. 4.5 minutes to go before the intermission. Freshman Nunez lets it go over the middle, caught by Adams. And he's got a first down for South Carolina.
Exactly what we talked about in the open in terms of the middle of the field and the tight end being an option there for Nunez. Right here, the play fake holding the linebackers, and then a nice quick pass to his tight end, Adams.
So Nunez finding some rhythm. Here's Carson, who gets dragged down. Let's check in with Laura.
Well, Farrell Cooper continues to be such a great leader on this offense, and he's always communicating with Nunez, telling him to be comfortable, calm, relaxed, reminding him this is a game that he's played his entire life and to focus on that. He's also saying that he thinks Nunez makes him a lot better because of the threat to run opposing defenses have a lot to think about with those two guys.
Yeah, Farrell Cooper's been looking for somebody to help him spread the field. Jarrell Adams, a tight end, has been one of those guys too for South Carolina.
Yeah, we felt like he was going to be a threat in this game. The way that Barry Odom loves to play some two high safeties, going to be a lot of...
Uh-oh, picked up by Carson again.
Oh, what a heads-up play.
Sean Carson has made two heads-up plays today for South Carolina. The redshirt senior from tiny Scranton, South Carolina.
Now, that's when you turn the film on tomorrow and you're looking at this and you realize his concentration level is he's focused today because he's there on the touchdown reception and really saving the day on that play. Because that's a momentum-changing play if Missouri picks that up or recovers the fumble or it goes for a loss and you find yourself in third and long again.
Instead, it's a third and six. Timeout taken by Steve Spurrier in South Carolina. So big third down coming up for the Gamecocks. They'll talk about it. We'll return to Columbia in a moment.
Not stop him. That's for sure.
17 to 10 here. I mean, even every coach we've talked to has raved about Leonard Fournette. Gary Pinkel yesterday said,
oh, yeah,
I had to double check our schedule, see if we had him in our future before that guy would be
next
gone.
Year.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, a couple of young quarterbacks answering drives. Drew Lock answers the touchdown pass to Nunez, and Nunez here, if he can convert and continue this drive, South Carolina in a position to score.
Remember, they converted a fourth down already today. That one floated to the outside, caught Cooper. First down, South Carolina takes it to the 20. Penton with the tackle for Missouri.
Boy, a nice job of sitting in there, and they bring some heat. South Carolina able to pick it up, and that allowed for the time for Nunez to scan the field and then find Cooper for the first down. Well, that's playing like a junior. Fast forward a couple of years. I think the more he plays, the better he's going to get.
Here's David Williams, left side. Submarine at the line of scrimmage, no gain. Josh Augusta in to make the stop. Remember, Missouri playing without freshman sensation Terry Beckner Jr. ejected in the first half earlier this quarter for targeting.
There, Nunez. That's one of the quarterback runs I thought he would pull it, as they went crashing down inside Missouri defensively, and he was out on the corner all alone.
They found their rhythm in the second quarter.
Donovan Newsom over Farrell Cooper. I like the matchup for South Carolina.
Looking that way, Nunez pops in the backfield. He never got free of Kentrell Brothers.
Yeah, it was not a run-pass option. It was pure run. And this Missouri defense showing some quickness here. You see everybody else down the field looking to block, and it was just a pure quarterback run. That was the call, and Brothers makes a nice play. Leads this team in tackles and has the last 2 years.
And now they're going to have to bring in Perry Orth here. He pulls the helmet on after Nunez shuffles off with a limp, a noticeable limp. Third down, Perry Orth was a starter a couple weeks ago. He's worked his way in to a playing role this season after the early injury to Connor Mitch.
It was a walk-on.
Made his first start against Georgia and got swarmed by the Georgia defense. Third and 16. Orth lets it go way short of the sticks and blasted as David Williams by Brothers.
May have got him in a position to kick a field goal here with Elliott Frye, who's range is about 50 yards and in. The last couple of weeks, he's kicked one. He's been good from 51 and 52 yards the last 2 weeks.
That's not a good sign right there for South Carolina and Nunez.
Oh, no way is that. And we were concerned. That was the amount of just pure quarterback runs that were being called. You're going to do that, you got to give him an option to get rid of the football, run pass option, and where he could just throw it away. Missouri's way too fast defensively for him to get the edges on a consistent basis. You can't make a living doing that if you're Steve Spurrier in South Carolina offensively.
Here's Nunez at the tail end of that run. It looked like he was slowing down before he was even brought down.
Yeah, you see Farrell Cooper at the top blocking. You see, as Will Calton heard, they were trying, he was blocking or engaged in a block. So it was a pure quarterback run to the edge of the defense that didn't fool anyone.
I guess if you're South Carolina, the hope here is that that's just a cramp, but it is a cool, crisp fall day. It's sunny, yeah, but only about 60 degrees right now. So it might look warmer than it is on the television screen. He's 10 of 14 with a touchdown pass. Laura?
Nunez was dealing with a right ankle situation. The athletic trainers were getting him to move it up and down and move it all around. He smiled and said, I'm good, I'm okay. He stood up, jumped around a little bit, and said he was all right. So we'll see what happens here.
All right, so it's a kicking situation now for Elliott Fry. He's already made one today. A pair of long ones last week. This would be a 39-yard attempt. He missed from 49 last week, his only miss. And we got a flag down. That one was wide left.
False start.
Oh,
74.
Boy.
Offense. 5-yard penalty remains, fourth down.
And this is trying to kick this into the breeze.
And it's a tricky wind here,
yeah,
going into that end zone. It's not straight on, it's kind of a crosswind coming off that hill.
I don't know that he had the distance. Forget the accuracy, but the distance for it to be good. And now you push him back 5 more yards with the breeze into his face.
He hit one from 51 and 52 last week. This would be a 44-yarder now. And that one will stay right. First one missed left, second one missed right. And a missed opportunity for South Carolina. Well, but most concern for the Gamecocks, though.
Well, this
is leg injury to Nunez.
If I'm Josh Henson right now after that big miss by Fry, I'm going up top. I'm going to take a shot here. In 38 seconds, let's see if we can get the ball down the field, maybe get a pass interference call. But a big turn, you know, turn of events like this, you miss two. And now South Carolina's down a little bit. Maybe you catch the defense or a defensive back asleep. But I would definitely take a shot here. Sudden change.
Well,
looks like they're going to go ahead and just go into take a knee and go into halftime.
17-point first half.
You know my rule in the first half of games, right? There's never too many points scored in the first half. Never enough scored in the first half of a football game. There's time on the clock. You're trying to score.
It's a Missouri team that this season is averaging fewer than 21 points a game, 115th in the country. They're well on the way to bettering that mark in an SEC contest under the true freshman quarterback, Drew Locke. Disturbing trend continues for the Gamecocks. They have trailed every game this season at the half. They came from behind for a couple of wins already this season, late against North Carolina in the opener, and third quarter comeback against UCF at home last week. We'll hear from Laura Rutledge with Coach Gary Pinkel coming up on the SEC Network Halftime Report. Our score in Columbia, 17-10. Now to Peter Burns in the studio.
All right, thank you, gentlemen.
Coach, so far Drew Locke has found a great connection with Nate Brown. How would you assess your freshman quarterback?
I think he's doing a lot of good things. You know, he took a sack or two, but I think he's doing a lot of good things. I think he's competing, and I think that he's having fun competing, and I think that's what we're asking him to do.
You told us that you would need to know where Lorenzo Nunez was at all times. How has your defense done that?
Well, they convert about 3 or 4 third downs on us, third and longs, and they've done a good job converting those. But we're trying to do the best we can, and they got a lot of good players, and we got to focus on trying to play by play and doing good things.
Thanks, Coach.
Thanks.
According to the Missouri Sports Information Department, this is the first time two true freshman QBs have started in the same game in SEC history. Locke has completed 84% of his passes and thrown for 2 touchdowns, and Nunez hasn't been as effective running as he was last week when he ran for 123 yards against UCF.
Between the Gamecocks and the Tigers, it's a touchdown game at the half with Drew Locke, the true freshman quarterback from Missouri, getting the Tigers off to a good start. First time in SEC history, true freshman quarterbacks have gone head-to-head, and Lorenzo Nunez has been fine in his own right. Missouri, great game on the ground thus far. South Carolina's numbers look ugly because of the sacks they've allowed, 4 of them to Missouri, and they pressured their freshman Nunez a few times. Vitale back to return, along with Sean Carson for South Carolina. And Carson watches it trickle through the back of the end zone. Let's go down to the field and check in with Laura.
Well, Steve Spurrier said Lorenzo Nunez is healthy. He was kicked in the ankle and upper shin. And trainers said he shouldn't have even come off the field because he was actually fine. Spurrier also saying that Nunez is running too much. He's sensing pressure that isn't even there. He said we have to run inside better. And he commented on Missouri quarterback Drew Lock, saying he throws a beautiful ball and a nice quick release.
How about that?
That's comical because the play he came off on was a designed run. I mean, it was a pure quarterback run. So to say he's running too much, it's kind of funny. Everybody's blocking down the field. He fakes some pulls and then gets himself shaken up.
Nunez wears number 19. Been wearing that number since he was a true freshman in high school at Harrison High School, just outside of Atlanta. So that was the last freshman to make the varsity team. When they passed out jerseys, 19 was the last one to come out. I didn't have a choice, he said, but I've fallen in love with it since, and I'll keep it going forward.
What if he can find some rhythm throwing the football here? He's going to have his team in a position to win this ball game.
Pressure coming from the right side, and he flicks it to the sideline. Flag down. That'll be intentional grounding. Donovan Newsom came after him. Actually, two flags. There's another one on the far side, about where the South Carolina receiver was coming out of his break.
I know he didn't get outside the tackle box, so that's going to draw the first flag. Not sure about the one that's in that the area in which you just described. That pressure right away.
Barry Odom came here from Memphis, a fifth in the country in scoring defense last year. New defensive coordinator for Gary Pinkel's squad.
There's two fouls on the play. Holding number 11, defense, intentional grounding, offense, those penalties offset. Second out.
Yeah, Arian Penton, team's best cover man, who actually should have had an interception, but what, you see the pressure right off the edge, right into Nunez's face, and that caused the quick throw out of bounds. He was not outside the tackle box there. The hold on the back end is just going to allow us to do it all over again. And there's Cooper. There's the outlet right there. See how far the safety's playing here?
Right to Adams, a tight end. He's got a first down and tripped up shy of the 40 by Ian Simon. Pickup of 13.
Well, they do a nice job, and that's a really good read on the part of Nunez. The safety's going to creep up. You see him creep up to get closer to Cooper. Well, that leaves a void. It creates some space for Adams to just really release off the ball. A nice quick throw and a quick read by Nunez gives him a first down.
Missouri showing blitz again. Cooper will take it to the right side. There's another aspect in play here with this Missouri defense. In years past, they were so good up front that they could get pressure by only bringing four, one of the best in the country. Now Barry Odom doesn't have that same talent level up front. If he wants to dial up pressure, he's got to bring an extra guy.
Charles Harris seems like he's going to be a guy that they can depend on in that role. And Brady, as well, has already got a sack in this ball game. He seems to be coming along as a young player, a redshirt freshman.
Second down, four. Fake to Carson. Nunez chased again. Gets out of trouble and flicks it incomplete. He had Josh Augusta trailing him towards the sideline, the junior from Peoria, Illinois.
You mentioned that he moves well for a player at 335 pounds. Big time run stuffer. He made a nice play in the first half of this ball game. Now giving chase as a pass rusher.
And he'll get some extra snaps after Terry Beckner Jr. was ejected for targeting.
He's showing some blitz inside. This is where I don't like the shotgun, because on third and five, and you have these type of offenses that look to the sideline, there's no hard count here. You can't draw anybody outside.
Shearer coming on that blitz up the middle. They tried to go option left. Look at this. Nunez cuts it back, and he tripped over the 50-yard line. Otherwise, He'd had a few more. It's a 7-yard run for Lorenzo Nunez in a first down after a little ad lib on the busted option. Well,
usually when you have a two-man option play right there, you see one, two outside the tackle. That's a indicator as a quarterback to change out of it, get out of that play, because it's a guy can account for the quarterback and the pitch man, but just the athletic ability of Nunez bails him out.
Carson ridden down from behind after a gain of one. Josh Moore in on the stop for Missouri.
That rule, or when you run the option with just one man, quarterback and a pitch man, there's two guys outside the tackle, check out of the play, because now you're accounting, everybody's accounted for. You want it when there's just a guy head up on the tackle, and that's who I'm reading.
But that recognition has to come after the ball is snapped when you're already on the move.
No doubt about it. But you should see it pre-snap read, and that will give you the indicator to change the play.
Second down, 9. Nunez looking for a crossing route. He's got all day. He lets it go down the sideline. It is intercepted. Picked off by Kenya Dennis. Trying to find Farrell Cooper.
Well, the wind certainly playing in a factor in that throw. He's late with it, number one, but two, it seems like it's held up in the air a long time and allowed Kenya Dennis an opportunity to get back and make a play on this ball. He leaves Kyle Markway, the tight end, falls back in coverage and basically just fights to take the ball away from Farrell Cooper.
If he leads him and doesn't have to deal with that win, that's a touchdown.
Yeah, he pops open, and hey, boy, that's a nice play by Dennis, though.
So Drew Locke at the controls, first freshman to start at quarterback since Corby Jones did in 95 for the Tigers. Complete to Nate Brown. Jordan Diggs with the tackle. Gain of 3. Missouri running game was really the key for the Tigers in the first half. They came in. The running backs came in averaging less than 75 yards a game. Already 88 on the ground for the Tigers today.
Throw in some additional yards by the quarterback and put them up over 100, but still really struggling to run the football with any type of consistency.
Here's Hansbrough. Still not 100%, playing on a bum ankle, injured it on his second carry of the season in the home opener against Southeast Missouri State.
That'll contribute to some struggles as well when your best running back is fighting through the season on a bad wheel. You see him here asking out in a serious limp. Hansbrough.
They tried to play him against Kentucky last Saturday night. He was ineffective on that ankle.
You got just what you want, locked up man across the board.
Incomplete. Trying to find Jason Reese. Al Harris Jr. with the coverage. Pardon me, Leftwich, the intended receiver.
If I can take a look at that Hansbrough run, and you see him here fighting for additional yards. No one is just not there.
And Andre, you can see him keep that right ankle off the ground.
Yeah.
Instead of churning.
Doesn't want to put any pressure on it. Still, it comes up a little bit. Comes up a little bit gimpy and has to leave the game.
Farrell Cooper stands near the 25. Fatone, the freshman, with a missed kick there. We'll see where they mark it. 17-10, South Carolina with another crack at it here in the second half. Touchdown lead for Missouri here in the third quarter at Faurot Field in Columbia. Tom Hart alongside Andre Ware. We've spent a lot of time talking about Missouri's true freshman quarterback. South Carolina's had one of their own. Even this, though this isn't Steve Spurrier's typical offense, right, they've had some success today.
Well, some ups and downs from Lorenzo Nunez. He's completed some passes down the field. The one to Farrell Cooper, who made a really dynamic catch. Ball was out quickly where he can make an adjustment, go climb the ladder and make a play for his young quarterback. Moving to his left, or moving out of the pocket, so to speak, moving around. But then in the running game, he struggled a little bit doing that. I think they're running him a little bit too much. They're going to have to get some production out of the backs, out of Williams and Carson, who only have 10 carries combined between the two of them.
For only 18 yards out of the two running backs. Nunez keeps this time. He's got some room. And Nunez slips his way through a would-be ankle tackle for an 8-yard gain. South Carolina offense found its rhythm in the second quarter. He finished the first half 10 of 14 for 141 and a Karam touchdown.
He's got the interception where he's late on a throw to the outside, trying to go to Cooper again.
Up the middle, nothing doing, no gain.
Yeah, and that's where it's been tough for South Carolina, which is why there's so much pressure on Nunez to deliver in the running game. Williams can't seem to get himself going. Carson, who had the touchdown reception on the deflection, but that's been about it.
This is a pivotal play in the third quarter. This is a pivotal game for Steve Spurrier and South Carolina. They dropped this one. They fall to 0-3 in the conference. They haven't done that since Spurrier's first year in Columbia.
The safety's bouncing over to help out on Cooper. Will might be right here.
Just got the playoff option pitch. Williams cuts it back. He's got a first down pass midfield. Michael Shear with a tackle after a gain of 8.
Yeah, they sensed. Coach Spurrier senses that they're trying to get the safeties over to help. There it is what I'm talking about. Optioning off the defensive end, Charles Harris, with nobody to account for, the pitch man. The help's got to come from deep. A linebacker and Brothers who can't get out there in time allows Williams to hit the corner and pick up the first down.
12th first down of the game for the Gamecocks. Design draw here. Nunez changes direction. Bends it to the outside, and he's got it down inside the 30 on an 18-yard run.
Boy, he is going to be a dangerous player as he continues to grow because he can do this. So give defensive coordinators fits. He's so athletic, and when he develops a little bit better as a passer where they can rely on that part of his game, boy, all bets are on.
And now to Cooper, snuffed out by Dennis, who has an interception today. You know, Steve Spurrier told Laura at the half, we're running it too much with him, but they're caught in a catch 22.
Right.
That's where this offense has been effective with him running the football. So where do you draw the line?
Well, he's a playmaker, definitely, but you need some guys around him to make some plays as well. And he's going to have a running game to go along with that. But otherwise, you subject him to injury, you know, going forward with as many carries or as many times as he's carrying the football.
On play action, he's going over the top, overthrew his man. It's an interception. Ian Simon was waiting in center field.
I think he just hung this one up. Really didn't read anything out there. And two deep coverage. The corner has no flat threat. He's sinking back. The safety's sitting there waiting on the football. I mean, you got to trust your eyes and read. And Nunez just hangs this one up.
South Carolina has had 6 possessions in Missouri territory. They've come up with a total of 10 points. Second pick for the Tigers today.
Missouri, take a look at this last play. Receiver on the outside. Belton's going to take a nice outside release. The throw, the correct read, frees it there. This throw should be knifed in there this way as opposed to the lob shot that Nunez throws. It's the correct read. It just has to be drilled rather than floated in there.
And so Missouri with a long field to work with, a gain of 2.
It's actually one of the weaknesses in cover two. Once the corner, if you have a flat threat with which the back came out and caused the corner to look back inside, now there's an area, a void between the safety and the corner, and it's a nice shot. And it's a pretty throw when you make it, but you cannot put air under the football when you recognize that coverage.
Tyler Hunt is in at running back for Missouri. Locke will check with the sideline. Plays coming in from Andy Hill and company. And they'll make an adjustment. Play clock is under 5. Here's Hunt. Straight ahead. And he gets dragged down by Sky Moore. Let's check in with Laura.
Well, Tom, Russell Hansbrough playing through a lot of pain with his ankle injury. And he's telling the trainers that he wants to get out there, wants to be out there and playing. But they're trying to make sure that he's okay. They're doing as many exercises as they can with him on the sideline to see if he's going to be all right to go.
Laura, thanks. He's obviously, you know, less than 100% in this situation. You'd love to have Russell Hansbrough in the game. Instead, they were forced to go with Tyler Hunt on a couple of carries. 3rd and 3. Ishwitter now in a tailback. Play action. Almost picked one right through the hands of TJ Holloman. He had two last week against UCF, and that one might have been a pick six.
Boy, usually a sure-handed defender. And I mean, this is just getting in the throwing lane of the quarterback. Nice job of reading the eyes of Drew Locke. Right here, you see him. He's eyeing the slant, and that is a pick six if Holloman's able to hold on to it.
Cooper stands in the logo at the 45-yard line.
Holloman has really started to play well.
Tony's been shaky today after a great week last week. And Cooper watches it fall in front of him. Down by Missouri, just outside the 45. 45-yard punt from the freshman Corey Fatone. South Carolina will have another crack at it. Lorenzo Nunez and Farrell Cooper back to work after this. On the spot, Andre, if South Carolina can't get it straightened out, if they lose today and they continue to slide, as Carson takes this carry up the middle, what does the future hold for Steve Spurrier going forward?
I think he's done enough to where, you know, he kind of gets that year where it's a rebuilding year, so to speak.
Well, obviously, I just meant from his perspective. Is this something he's going to want to stick around?
He's going to want to fix this. There's no doubt about it. He is not going to walk away from things the way they are, especially the heights he's taken this program to. There's no doubt about it that I think he'll stick around and try to right the ship.
Three straight 11-win seasons before last year. And they made some changes to the defensive staff, bringing in John Hope. Another interception. It's a third of the game for Missouri. Walter Brady has two sacks and a pick and a monster game for the Tiger defense.
You know, you got to know coverages, and pre-snap read gives you a pretty good indicator of man and zone, and he's going to get pressure. But you have to be willing to stand in there against pressure. Pressure's coming. You're going to have to stand in there against it. He's thinking about a tight end, the tight end Adams. You see Adams right there. Instead of just putting the ball on him, he puts it in an area, and that allowed Brady to come up with the interception. The team's third of the day. Oh, right there. I mean, right to a defensive lineman just waiting on it.
Missouri had four interceptions on the season. They've got three today. .617 to go. Back on offense, the Tigers, and Ishwitter with a 7-yard gain. Six minutes to go, third quarter. South Carolina had multiple opportunities to find a game-tying touchdown here in the third quarter. But Nunez is finding the wrong color jersey. That was a floated snap. Witter brought down by his ankle. DJ Smith with the tackle, pickup of six.
Well, you just have to know, you know, coverages and man-to-man, you can lead receivers. You throw them away. You throw them open, away from defenders. In zone coverage, you put the ball on receivers. And when Adams turned around, he was expecting the ball between the 8 and the 9, and it was floating over the middle for Walter Brady.
Drew Locke looking in zone, throws pylon, nearly picked. Al Harris Jr. with the play on the ball that was headed out of bounds.
It'd be tough for Harris to make a play on this, but still, he gives his receiver there, Wingo, a chance to come up with a play. I like the throw up because it's high and it's outside. It's not going to go back towards, you know, in the area of play. So you still give Ray Wingo a chance to make a play on it.
Two touchdowns on three trips into the red zone for Missouri. Locke swings it outside. He finds Nate Brown. And Brown takes it inside the 10. Pickup of 10.
A nice job of running after the catch. And then the nice block by Wesley Leftwich on the outside to free up Nate Brown. Quick throw, excellent block, and then finishing at the end of it. Nate Brown has stepped up, hadn't he? Wesley with a Wesley Leftwich with a nice block. And Brown right down here around the red zone again. Already two touchdown receptions on the afternoon.
They want to check the spot, and they're going to bring out the sticks to measure this one.
See the block here? That's what picks up the first down. Nice job of running after, but he doesn't even get out of the gate if Leftwich didn't throw in that block.
They got it. Nate Brown has been targeted six times today.
Why not go to him here again?
And two touchdowns, yeah.
6'3", 205, big receiver, big body. Catches the ball with his hands. I'm going right there again. We talked about his speed. He was came to Mizzou as a two-way player. He's a defensive back first. And now he's developed into a fine receiver.
Lock, pressure from behind, finds his tight end on the crossing route. That's Jason Reese, who gets dragged down at the three, a gain of five. TJ Holloman with the tackle.
This is excellent execution by Locke, because his eyes never leave the right side of the formation. He's looking right, trying to force the defense in zone coverage to move just a little bit to their left and allow Reese to come underneath.
Second and goal. Witter to the goal line and just shy, so that'll bring up third and goal.
Go right back to that play. This inside runner. He's in behind that offensive line of five seniors with all that experience, trying to quick snap South Carolina, maybe catch him out of position.
Load it up. Jumbo unit on the field. Lock dropped the snap, got it to Witter, and he's still able to barrel his way in. Touchdown Tigers. They won pretty. The Witter's got his first touchdown of the season.
Yeah, you see that every once in a while in teams that live in the shotgun. Then the quarterback's got to come under center. Quarterback center exchange, a little sloppy there, but when the athlete he is, Drew Locke's able to recover, still get the handoff to Witter, who gets himself into the end zone. That's one of the most underrated aspects of offense, or just the game of football, is quarterback center exchange.
If you mess that up,
can't go anywhere.
Baggett to attempt the extra point. Fits it through, and Missouri takes advantage of its third takeaway. An interception by Walter Brady gives the Tigers a short field. Brady with a nice return afterwards, and Drew Locke able to manufacture another touchdown drive. This time it's Ish Witter with the exclamation point.
Missouri leads South Carolina 24-10. Let's take a look at that interception by Lorenzo Nunez. He wants to go here to Adams, the tight end. They're going to blitz. You get a backside linebacker dropping in zone blitz. Now, right there, if you go ahead and just put the ball on the tight end, throw it right to him, the backside linebacker never becomes a factor. But if you know coverage, you don't throw it or lead a receiver in zone coverage, you put the ball on him between the 8 and the 9, you're safe. When you throw it up over the middle anticipating movement from Adams, that's where you get yourself in trouble.
Third pick of the day for the freshman Nunez. College football continues today at 4 p.m. on SEC Network. San Jose State will travel to the Plains to take that game at A&M. You know, you just don't expect great performances from true freshmen. Palmer, who had a great career at Florida, ended up throwing two picks in his first start. Only completed 8 of 14 for 92 yards.
Some of this is just recognition of coverages. You get so, you know, focused on zone reads, and you get in a situation where you have to throw the ball. You hadn't spent a whole lot of practice time on reading, just reading defenses.
They'll take off after the coverage is good downfield, and Nunez is able to scramble to a pickup of 7. Kentrell Brothers.
I still think, though, even with the mistakes, he's athletic enough. There's plenty of time in this football game. We have an entire fourth quarter. Defense steps up, a couple of turnovers. He hits a big play. They're very much back in this ball game if they can get on the scoreboard here. But I think he's got enough athletic ability that he's got some stuff you can't teach. Now you develop him as a passer, or you have got yourself a weapon.
On second and three, they're going to go play action again. Nunez fits it and finds his tight end. And that's a South Carolina first down. I think I know your answer to this, but he's thrown three picks today. But there's no reason in your mind that they would use Perry Orth in this game. Nunez is their guy.
Not at all. I think Nunez is the guy. The only way he gets better is he learns from the mistakes, the things that I just talked about and described as, you know, in zone cover. You don't lead guys in zone. You get them knocked out if you lead them into defenders. You put the ball on him in man-to-man coverage. Those are things he's having to learn pretty much on the fly because there's been three other guys in front of him.
That was Kyle Markway, the tight end, with his first catch in the last play. Fresh set of downs for the Cox. And to the ground game, and a nice run by David Williams. And he finally gets tripped up on the turf just shy of the 40. It's a 13-yard run.
Well, nice job inside. And this is really what you need to have. Defensive end gets blocked. Williams providing a spark in the running game. That takes some pressure off the youngster, Nunez.
Here's Williams again. Gain of three, Laura.
Well, you can see that the South Carolina team supports Lorenzo Nunez despite his struggles today. Coming up to him, a lot of different guys giving him pats on the back, telling him it's going to be okay. Even Spurrier came over and gave him a little pat on the back after the third interception that he threw. So you do see that there is support for him on this sideline.
Yeah, even Dante Sawyer, after he threw the second one, was the first, you know, South Carolina player to reach him, a defensive tackle going in, hey, we're going to get you the football back. And they're behind it. They realize they're very much still in this ball game.
David Williams, the running back, is the injured Gamecock. I must have just had the wind knocked out of him because he popped up just fine.
Well, everybody wanted this kid out of high school. Chose South Carolina over Ohio State, Arizona State, Tennessee, and Auburn. All were hot on his trails to try to sign him. He just gets himself twisted backwards a little bit where his legs are caught underneath him.
Good to see him pop up and come off the field as the athletic training staff takes another look at him.
They find a way to get Cooper involved in things here offensively as well.
Now Carson is now the tailback, cuts it back and runs right into Kentrell Brothers. Fifth-year senior from Guthrie, Oklahoma. Had 10 tackles against Kentucky, leading the nation in tackles coming into this game.
Well, we talked to Barry Odom, the defensive coordinator for Missouri, and he told us three things, three keys: eliminate big plays, create turnovers, and play with great emotion. The last one, playing with emotion. A lot of yellow and black jerseys around Sean Carson. They created turnovers, three interceptions in this ball game, and only one big play to Pharaoh Cooper, the big play down the sideline.
Third down, 7. Carolina 4 of 9 on third downs today. Play clock is at 5. Flag. Nunez floats another one. Incomplete.
Dreaded area of holding.
Holding number 71. Offense, 10-yard penalty, replay third down.
Brandon Schell, the left tackle.
Keep an eye here. Right there, he gets beaten underneath by Charles Harris, and no choice but to grab. Nice job by Harris is setting him up. He starts outside and in a quick underneath move. And Schell is still in his kick to get outside. He just swims right underneath him.
Third and 17.
Yeah, this is where you have to avoid a mistake here by a young quarterback, and Nunez trying to pick up this first down.
They'll try to scramble with it. Spins and goes nowhere. Michael Shear and Thomas Wilson converge to bring him down.
He's not able to get much out of the running game. Most of it's been in the form of Lorenzo Nunez, who you throw the sack totals in there as well. Those really make the numbers look scarce.
Nunez bothered by that ankle injury earlier this game, still showing the effects of it a little bit on the sideline.
I'm gonna have to run some fly sweeps or something, find a way to get Farrell Cooper involved.
Three quarters of play in the books here in Columbia, Missouri, in a battle for the Columbia Cup, leaning towards the guys from the Show Me State. We hit the fourth quarter, 24-10 Tigers.
Be aware, the last two times these teams have played, close. The fourth quarter's been a different story. We've had comeback wins each of the last 2 years. South Carolina did it here 2 years ago. 17 points in the fourth quarter to force overtime and win. Now fourth and 15. Fair catch asked for Stateside to 10 by Cam Hilton. And that's where Drew Locke will bring the offense back out. It was pointed out earlier this season by Benjamin Hockman of the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. Drew Locke already has that SEC look with the Bama bangs or the Alabama swoop, whatever you want to call it. John Parker Wilson at Alabama had the look. Bo Wallace the last couple years. Jay Coker now for Bama. And Zach Mettenberger went all the way to the side. So Drew has the locks, the look. And this is him pregame getting that hair flipped down.
Baby face. He can throw it. Locks, hair, whatever you want to call it.
Locktober, locks.
Yeah, he can throw it.
Russell Hansborough back in the game trying to find some offense. Picks up one. Drew Locke, 19 of 25, 126, two touchdowns. And the game, you can see how the game plan kind of shifted early on. Josh Henson wanted to get him some easy throws. Those throws are giving them zero in the yardage department, but it seemed to have gotten Drew Locke on track.
Completions for confidence is what Josh Henson wanted for Drew Locke early in this ball game. It's also forced South Carolina to widen its defense out, and that's why the running game has kind of emerged in Lyon Witter and as well as Hansborough when he was in there to have a little bit of success.
Hansborough this time trying to get it to the outside. Great play from the safety spot from the outset by Jordan Diggs, who had that one sniffed out. He and Sky Moore converge to bring down Hansborough. Kind of same numbers that Grayson Lambert has put up for Georgia, finding consistency short and not having to take deep shots.
Yeah, and that's what basically South Carolina's going to give you. They like to run two deep zone. You're going to have an opportunity to hit the underneath stuff. They're trying to play with the two safeties over the top. They're not going to give you any big plays. They want to force you to methodically work the ball down the field in the passing game. You know what? He's just followed the game plan and executed it.
He's been heavily right-handed, 12 of 14 to the right side intermediate route. So now opening it up the middle. This is Tyler Hunt. He spins his way to first
close
down. Yeah, right at the marker. Tyler Hunt grew up a huge Missouri fan just up the road in the small town of Huntsville, Missouri.
Just short. I'll tell you what, they're going to have to take a look at this.
It needs to be past the 21-yard line.
When you have the short passing game, it opens up things inside. Yeah, credit the offensive line in both areas, both protecting the quarterback, Drew Locke, the freshman, as well as opening some holes. But now Tyler Hunt, when the season came in here, just 10 carries for 32 yards. And oh, my, just enough for a first down.
By an inch. So Tyler Hunt able to give Missouri a fresh set of downs. He's been angling for more playing time with the running game being inconsistent.
Injuries as well, kind of forcing the hand as you give Witter a break with Hansborough in and out of the lineup. You have to go to Tyler Hunt.
Witter again. And once again, up from the safety spot, Jordan Diggs combines with Marquavius Lewis. It's a gain of one.
Well, now you have South Carolina pinching down inside to stop the run.
linebackers, the two linebackers, five defensive backs. Now it's going to create opportunities on the outside. Now you got a linebacker and Sky Moore walking out over a slot receiver.
Moore's pretty good. He has three picks this year. That one tipped. Reacted by Jason Reese to haul it in for a gain of four.
Number 10 working against 10. Reese working against Moore, and they knew exactly where the young freshman Locke was thinking. You got a linebacker walking out in coverage on a tight end that is a good receiving tight end. That isn't tipped. You may have a chance, you know, for a missed tackle and a turn up for extra yards, but it's there. I mean, that's a gimme throw for the youngster, and he recognized it right at the pre-snap read.
They moved Moore to weak side linebacker. He's responded. Locke running a little option, and Ritter just past the line of scrimmage for one. T.J. Gurley with the stop.
Gurley recovering nicely. That spur position, which is the fifth defensive back for South Carolina, rallying up a nice open field tackle to save South Carolina and force a punt here from Missouri. But you've got outside leverage. You can't allow things to get outside of you, and you're one-on-one with a back. You got to make a nice tackle in the open field, and Gurley certainly did there. Well, I mean, they're very much in this ball game.
Cooper gets away from the punt. It's down by the Tigers. Tony with a 42-yarder that time. Two-touchdown lead for Missouri.
Brought to you by Belk. The Missouri defense, the one constant for this program over the last couple of years. Pair of trips to the SEC championship game, back-to-back East Division champs, and three picks today for the Missouri defense, not just their secondary.
The defensive line got involved with Walter Brady for the big interception. The zone blitz, and all of a sudden the football was floating in the air for it.
Missouri's had at least seven tackles for loss every game this season. They had 15 on the road against Arkansas State. The defense this season has been the thing that's kept Missouri in games. It's the offense that's had a good game as well today. Nunez pressured and flicks it complete. Shy of the line of scrimmage, it'll be a loss of two, but had to work to get out of trouble and still took a shot from behind.
Yeah, and right away, Adams is open. I mean, right now he's open. You just have to trust your eyes and know where receivers are on the field. It's zone coverage. He does a nice job of sitting down, presenting the numbers to the quarterback. As soon as you hit the last step in the drop, let him have it. You wait a little bit long, all of a sudden you're inviting the rush into your lap, and then you wind up with a loss on first down. Just got to trust it and let the ball come out.
It was Marcel Frazier who had the pressure chasing down Nunez from behind. Nunez looks flushed, flicks, and good catch. Nope, they say out of bounds. Belton had his heels on the line.
Another situation where a receiver's running wide open. You're going to see right here, a receiver's going to come wide open right here. Now it's just time to give it to him. As soon as you drop, the receiver's wide open right now, and there's a passing lane to get him the football. You pull it down, you start running around with him, everything gets out of sync.
Is he gun shy because he's a freshman, or is it because he's thrown three picks today?
Well, I think it's partly both, that there's some inexperience there. You've turned the ball over. You're not quite trusting what you're seeing right now. And so there's that tad bit of hesitation in which he's playing with.
Third down, 12. Pressure coming. Nunez escapes. And he does it again. A masterful move for the first down. And Nunez, the freshman, shows his wheels to the tune of a 29-yard escape. But he's still on the turf.
Tell you what, he is. That's runs like that are what keep him in the game, and I think he's got all the tools. He's just got to trust what he's seeing. You know, he'll learn from this film, and he'll be so much better next week, having gone through some of this stuff. Right now, I'm hoping he's able to get himself up and get back in this game.
We've got a timeout on the field as the athletic training staff tends to Lorenzo Nunez. 10 on South Carolina here. And Lorenzo Nunez trying to get loose in that sideline. Here's a look at the tail end of that play. An awkward landing on his hip and shoulder. And it looked like the training staff was checking out his right shoulder on the sideline.
Yeah, it looked like John Gibson, the defensive back, rolls up on him, and he's down throwing on the sideline, maybe back in this game in a couple of plays.
Second snap for Perry Orth, and he's going deep. Almost picked. That one dropped by Anthony Sherrills.
Looked like Adams didn't think he was going to get the football. Little linebacker running with him. You see here, just turns and runs down the middle of the field, trying to squeeze it between the safety and the linebacker in down the middle. Shears, the linebacker in coverage, and Moore almost delivered.
Corner blitz coming. They hand it off, and Williams held a no gain. Walter Brady's having a heck of a game for Missouri, the redshirt freshman from Florence, Alabama.
You gotta take your hat off to this Missouri defense. Shutting down the running game from a running back standpoint. 16 carries, about 45 yards for the running backs of South Carolina.
Third down, 10. Three-man rush to the screen. Farrell Cooper spins again. He's looking for the sideline, and Cooper brought down just a yard and a half short.
Well, there's decisions made. I think you go for it here. Fourth down, a yard or so, about 2 yards maybe short of the first down marker.
Gotta go for it.
You have to. You need points. Possessions are limited going forward. Got to go for it here.
Farrell Cooper, 9 catches, 102 yards. Seems to be Perry Orth's game going forward.
And you're defending 10 as opposed to 11 if you're Barry Odom. A little bit easier to call the defense when you know the quarterback's not quite as mobile.
You'd think if Nunez was healthy enough to play, this would be his kind of play.
No doubt about it. No doubt.
Play clock at 1. They don't get it off. Do they get a timeout? Perry Orth was changing at the line of scrimmage.
Timeout.
And South Carolina just gets a timeout call before they incur the penalty.
This half. This will be a 30-second timeout.
So they'll still be looking at a 4th and 1. Yep. All right, a little help from the sideline. Coach, play clock.
Yep. Trying to get something called and was able to get that timeout to save a 4th and 6, keep it at 4th and 1.
Steve Spurrier pointed out he's got Sean Elliott, the offensive coordinator, offensive line coach, calling a lot of the run plays along with G.A. Mangus. Elliott was a line coach at Appalachian State when they had a great running quarterback, Armani Edwards.
Oh, yeah.
And he said this, we remember, he was the guy that beat Michigan. Yep. He was one of the best rushing quarterbacks in FCS history. And Spurrier pointed out this week, he said, listen, this isn't my offense. Where we are right now with Lorenzo Nunez, this is not what I brought in. This is basically what those guys are running. Now, with Perry Orth back on the field, it might shift a little bit back to what Steve Spurrier is comfortable with.
Yeah, more predominantly pass game first. But he came in, he told us he wanted to run the ball about 65% of the time. That's with quarterback runs included. I'm going to believe they're somewhere around that, those percentages.
South Carolina has converted 5 of 7 fourth downs this season. That's an incredible number. This is a long one. Orth on the play action. Looking. Now he's going to run, and he scrambles for the first down.
Nice job there. I thought he had a receiver open down in the flat. Maybe Farrell Cooper initially to pick up the first down, but trusted his legs a little bit more than his arm. You see Farrell Cooper right there. He's open. He's looking back inside. You just need a yard. There's no need to throw back across the middle, but you got your best playmaker. I'd rather see him with the ball in his hands.
Orth pulls it back, trying to get anything, and he gets up with a gain of 4 to the 25-yard line. Perry Orth, when he first showed up on campus back in the spring of 2012, was a 6th-string walk-on. He didn't earn a scholarship until this fall, and as you may know as a South Carolina fan, he was working at a local supermarket over the course of the summer. So he's gone from 6th-string walk-on and shelf stalker to a starting quarterback in the SEC. He got the call against Georgia, and now this fourth quarter seems to be his. Can he engineer another South Carolina comeback here in the Show Me State? Going down the sideline and just too much. Trying to lead Carlton Hurd, overthrew him.
Well, you can just see the body language of Jarrell Adams and frustrated as he was wide open. He goes down the sideline to Hurd, but the reason the safety and it's condensed so much, that leaves the tight end open. Safety's off the hash trying to help with a wide out. You take your eyes, you look hard there and come back to the tight end who may have walked into the end zone.
Rob Talley is in a tailback now. He escapes. Orts got him in the flat wide open. Flag down. Talley to the goal line and in. It will be a 25-yard catch and run touchdown if it stands.
I don't know if there was a hold or maybe a screen. Pass interference that... Yeah, they're going to call it on Farrell Cooper.
Pass interference, number 11, offense. 15-yard penalty, replay, third down.
Yeah, he comes in and he screens for the running back. So watch Farrell Cooper come from outside. Excuse me here. He's going to come from the outside and screen right in here, and that's going to allow the running back to come across freely. There it is, right there. Got to present the look to the officials that you're trying to sell it, that you're trying to run a route, and the defender's in your way. Give a swim move, anything.
Put your
hands
up.
Trying to get open, or you know, turn around and show your numbers to the quarterback. But if you just roll in there and just run a pick, they're going to get you for it every time.
They're down in Jeff City for South Carolina. Orth. Gathers, floats it, batted away. He had Adams for a brief moment. He had Cooper in the area. John Gibson knocked it down.
And JG, one of the final recruits in his class a couple of years ago, was an Arkansas commit. And they dropped him. He ends up here, dropped him late in the process. He ends up here at Missouri. He's that fifth cornerback that comes in. They go Penton inside. And then he comes in the game at corner. He's done a nice job, had a nice game today.
Cam Hilton stands inside the 10. Sean Kelly trying to kill this one. And we'll see, that one was Mark. It was Talley who was down there. And he was able to bat it back. Missouri will have a long field, but they're working with a 2-touchdown lead after that 37-yard punt from Sean Kelly.
Are you in good hands?
Last two matchups between these two teams that decided late, and we got 6:42 to go here on a golden Saturday afternoon in Columbia. Tigers with a 2-touchdown lead. Drew Locke has been sparkling today, true freshman.
Yeah, opened up and showed some patience against the true zone defense of two deep safeties. Nice job of running for a first down. Had to change launch points a couple of times. Was still accurate with the football. Outside, inside, showing you that he can make all the throws. And that one, the dart, he throws in there for a touchdown. To Nate Brown, 2-touchdown passes on the day, both to Nate Brown. But I'll tell you what, he has managed this game. Not a lot of yardage, but this defense doesn't call for giving up big plays. He's been precise with the football. Impressed with Drew Locke.
He's got Ish Witter in the backfield with him. Only less than 6.5 yards of completion for Drew Locke. As you mentioned, the yardage, kind of a simple attack just to take what that South Carolina defense has given them. Ish Witter, straight ahead. Let's check in with Laura.
Carolina quarterback Lorenzo Nunez dealing with a right shoulder injury down here. The athletic training staff put ice inside his jersey on that shoulder and told him that they would check back in with him and see how that's helping. He's saying that he can move his arm and he's got mobility in the shoulder, but it's hurting him to throw the ball. So no update on whether or not he comes back in the game, but I'll keep you posted.
Laura, thank you. We had a flag on the play after that Missouri run by Witter. You got him 2 yards.
Holding number 77. Offense, that penalty is declined. Second down.
That's senior Evan Baim, who's making his 44th start today.
Yeah, you know, it's unfortunate for Nunez that he's injured, but I think he's got all the tools. You know, he's making right reads. It's just the wrong delivery of the wrong type of throw, which tells me he's seeing things. He's seeing where he's supposed to go with the football. It's just how to get there or how to get to those things. But I tell you what, impressed with him as well, a young player who turned it over a few times today, but I saw some growth.
Locke trying to go deep. Just past the reach of Nate Brown.
Now that's how you beat cover two, is you knife one in there to Brown, try to knife it in to Nate Brown before the safety can make a play over the top. It's a more direct throw. You just kind of drill it in as opposed to lobbing it up, the interception we saw Nunez throw.
Drew Locke 5 of 9 for 35 yards on third down today.
Where he's been his best pretty much yardage wise.
Tigers have converted 50% of their third down chances. Blitz coming up the middle. Option look. Pitch to Witter. Cuts it back. He's got a first down and he's all the way out to the 19-yard line. Gain of 13. Well, Gary Pinkel insisted they weren't going to change the game plan with Drew Locke at quarterback in there.
Yeah, one out, one guy outside at the top. Right here. Well, we've got problem technical issues up here. But one guy, it's easy to read right there. And so it's an easy decision for the quarterback when you just have one guy on the outside to read. Bring it up, option off him, it was easy. He takes the quarterback, you pitch it.
Your picture page is broken over
there? Yeah, something's going on over here. Something's going on up over here.
Locke hands it off again. No gain for Ish Witter. Clock ticking on South Carolina. They're down 2 touchdowns. And after Laura's report on Nunez, it seems like it'll be Perry Orth's gig going forward in this game. And so
the bigger story is who's the starting quarterback going forward for Missouri after this performance by Drew Locke?
That question can't be answered.
Let's finish this thing first, 4:57, and then really dive into that.
Well, we and can't answer that question until you find out whether or not Matty Mock is going to be back in uniform for this team. Whether that's next week or down the road. Here's Jason Reese with the catch. We're talking with offensive coordinator Josh Henson yesterday.
Yeah.
He said, I told Drew the game's going to move really fast for you. And in a couple years, you're going to look back at this film and you're going to laugh. You go, man, I made so many mistakes in that game. He said, don't worry about it. You just got to go out there and play. He said, it'll even look better to you and a lot different for you 3 weeks from now. That looks pretty good thus far. We've got a timeout for South Carolina. They stopped the clock with 4:36 to go. Back in Columbia after this. From Faurot Field, 24-10 Missouri leads South Carolina. Let's take a look at the latest Dish. Brought to you by Dish. Full slate of action and some great ones under the lights. In SEC play, Alabama and Georgia get going in a soggy Sanford Stadium this afternoon. Ole Miss in Florida tonight at 7 on ESPN. Arkansas, Tennessee in a desperation game on ESPN2. And then this one on the network, Mississippi State and A&M. Kevin Sumlin hasn't beaten a ranked team at home.
I like Mississippi State on the road. I like Alabama, Ole Miss, Tennessee at home. That slate of games.
I agree with you except for that A&M. I'm going to go the other way with the Aggies.
Man, both teams. Both coaches need a win, Arkansas and Tennessee.
How about this? Designed quarterback draw for Locke, and he will scramble for a first down.
Yeah, that's where
I can't imagine Andre has gone any better for Drew Locke today than could have been wished for.
No, and you know what? I like his demeanor in a sense that when he throws the touchdown passes, there's a little bit of a fist pump, but he's right back to an even keel You know, and he almost throws the interception to T.J. Holloman, and he never really flinched. He's come back. He's played solid. Not really any peaks and valleys in his performance. It's been just steady all afternoon long.
He was an All-State basketball player in high school at Lee's Summit and part of a great All-State team. Jimmy Witt is a local kid who's playing now for Mike Anderson at Arkansas. Kid Monte Harrison committed to Nebraska, but he's playing pro baseball for the Brewers' second-round pick. Jason Tatum out of St. Louis signed with Duke on that team. And Jordan Barnett is a freshman out of Texas. So it's not like they're a bunch of scrubs in a first-team All-State selection. They're not just playing hoops. And the report I got, the kid can shoot a little bit. Hansborough with the carry. We'll bring up second down.
Second down, 7. Didn't throw it after a little
33.
Bit, too.
Yeah.
Getting in here, completing 60% of his passes. Only really one questionable throw in the game today.
Here's Witter, and a first down.
And this is the type of drive you need if you're Missouri. You need one of those put you to sleep type drives where it's methodical, it's frustrating. South Carolina with only one timeout really can't do much in terms of how they, you know, they stop the clock and then maybe try to get the ball back. They're going to spend it at some point, but well, this is where you turn it over to a senior offensive line who's loaded with experience, really needed to play better as a group, and they've delivered today.
Lock hands it off again. A punishing run by Tyler Hunt. 5'11", 210, and he picks up 9. Farmy Chase Abingdon, the junior college transfer with his first carry. And then waiting for Abington to show what he can do. Yeah. He gets an opportunity here late.
Yeah, big back at 6'2", 215 pounds. As you mentioned, junior college transfer. You can't draw it up any better for Josh Henson and Gary Pinkel in terms of how you want to finish this football game.
Here comes the blitz, straight ahead. Hansborough got enough for the first down. Well, Missouri going forward. Remember, they've always lost one head-scratcher doozy of a game over the last 2 years in conference and battled back to win the division. Could prove to be Kentucky, but it won't be easy. Florida's here for homecoming here at the school that invented homecoming next week. And then they got to go to Athens to take on a top 10 Georgia team.
At Georgia, at Vanderbilt, who has shown that they can move the ball in the SEC. They played some pretty good defense at Vanderbilt this year with Derek Mason taking over the play calling on that side of the ball. So that won't be an easy road trip for Missouri either.
Hansborough now over 2,000 yards in his career, the 15th running back in school history to cross that mark. Fans will hit the exits here for Old Field with kind of a new look on the season now. Not only 4-1, even money in conference play, but the savior quarterback, Drew Locke, lives up to the hype. True freshman making his first start, the first true freshman in Gary Pinkel's era of 39 years as a college coach to start a ball game, and he starts what could be a magical career with a win. He's our Capital One Cup impact performance. 21-28, 136, couple of scores. And you can bet there'll be more confidence for him going into the Florida game next week.
No doubt about it. Didn't really force the action. You know, he'll have some opportunities. Florida, they'll line up and test this receiving corps of Missouri's in man-to-man coverage, and that's when he'll really have to deliver. But against zone, he took what was there from John Hope defensively and managed the game well. Turned out two touchdown passes, and what he's off to a pretty good start in his career here at Missouri.
if Nunez is okay next week, you like enough of what you saw of him today going
yes,
forward?
Because I think they're correctable mistakes. I mean, you're identifying where to go with the football. It's just how to get it there. And that's the difference in Nunez right now and maybe a guy like Drew Lock. He understands the throws that are needed. But I think Nunez has a tremendous amount of growth. There's a high ceiling for him and a lot left there. Talent-wise, I think he's got all you need.
Let's get on the field. Laura's standing by with Gary Pinkel.
Thanks, Tom. Coach Drew Lock, 21 of 28, 136 yards through the air, two touchdowns. How was he able to get comfortable with some short completions early on in the game?
Well, you know, I guess, you know, he's had experience a little bit before the first few games, and I thought he went out and did a really good job. I think at the very end, we got really conservative with him, you know, and that's just a choice we made. But, you know, I'm pleased. I thought he did a good job. We ran the ball a lot better today, too.
You mentioned running the ball better. What made the difference there?
I just think we ran better and we blocked better. I think that's really, you know, really what we just weren't doing it very well. So hopefully we'll gain from this, learn from this, and continue to get better.
Did Drew Lock's performance today factor into starting conversation for next week?
No, I'm not discussing that.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.
Guys, Gary Pinkel. Drew Lock with the win, but still questions surround Matty Mock's suspension that will be answered later this week for Missouri. Drew Lock seems to have answered the questions today. His first start for the true freshman, and he finds a win. Our final, 24-10, Missouri over South Carolina. Coming up next, it's SEC Now. Here's Peter Burns. Back.